We're still hard at it out here in the shop, and we're working on the HQ200, of course. I've got pretty much all the bands are working, and reasonably good sensitivity around a microvolt. The Q multiplier, however, does not work at all. This is the Q multiplier section right here, and when you turn it on, I'm listening to a station now, and when I turn on the Q multiplier, it kills the signal altogether. So we got to get in there and do a little troubleshooting. This is not a complicated circuit, so let's see what we got. Check the voltages first. Okay, making some headway. I've verified that all the voltages on the triode section of the 12AX7, which run the Q multiplier, are okay. So that means that it's an adjustment problem. So anyway, I took apart the shaft and set control for the selectivity, and I come to find out that it indeed was terribly misadjusted. So I'm just using a tuning tool right now because I've got to reassemble it, but as you can hear, I'll turn it up a bit. I can adjust the selectivity just fine, and I could also adjust the depth of the Q multiplier. So the Q multiplier is okay. I just need to reassemble it and align it and adjust it. So looks like we're within striking distance of being able to put this back in the cabinet. Cheers. Okay, here we go. Got things reassembled, and there's with the Q multiplier off, on, and then I can tune through the bandpass, and I can increase the sensitivity of the Q multiplier and tighten it up. And you can see it on the S meter. Perfect. All right, I got to do the tightening down of the lock nuts, and it looks like we'll proceed with the alignment. Well, this is kind of interesting. I'm trying to put the shield cover back on, and the shield takes the tuning clear back into the next county, so I'm having to play with the adjustment a little bit to change the tuning so that it's on frequency when I put the shield cover back on. We're getting close. Okay, if you look really carefully in there, you can see that there's a stop that the larger or longer Allen set goes into, and that's got to be set up so that it corresponds with the appropriate location of the pointer on the front panel. So when I'm all the way over to the left of the travel, I can come up here, and here's the center of the bandpass right there. And then there's the other side. So got her dead on, and with the shield cover in place. Well, I was about an hour of screwing around with something that just refused to be aligned. And of course, the sensitivity adjustment will allow you to get pretty tight in there. There we go, right there. Narrows things up quite a bit if you're real careful with the adjustment. So there we go. I pronounced the Q multiplier fixed. Alrighty, moving up the food chain here. The BFO doesn't work. For whatever reason, it does not oscillate when I switch to the CWSSB mode. So again, voltage checks, and we'll look into it, see what's going on. Well, I've got the coil and the capacitor that goes down to the control grid disconnected, and yet I still have a short circuit to ground on the variable capacitor, whose plates don't appear to be touching anything, but Sure looks like that's what it is. Well, I found it. It's kind of hard to see, but essentially what's happening is that the stator is shorted out to ground. It's not supposed to be. The rotor, of course, is on a ground potential here with the shaft, and it's supposed to be grounded. But if you look very, very closely, you'll see that there's a tensioner that's, and you can see part of it sticking out there. But if you turn it around and look on the other side, hope I'm not making you dizzy here. If you look in there very carefully, you see it? The tensioner is rotated and it's touching the stator. So we're going to pry that off of there. And if you look at that closely, if you can, you'll see that it's no longer touching on either side. And that the ground lug is free and clear for the rotor, and the stator should be just fine. Had to use a pair of pliers to do it, but I don't know how it rotated, but it did. Together, and the FO is working now. So, wow. I pronounced the BFO, beat frequency oscillator, repaired. Now maybe I can get on to the alignment. Well, we're still at it. We're trying to make sense of the operation of the sideband system in this thing. And what it appears is these radios do not have sideband filters in them, per se. When you switch from upper to lower sideband, at least on this panel, it's a little misleading. You're not switching into lower sideband position or switching into upper sideband position. It just gives you an indication as to which way to tune to clarify the sideband if you're dead center on frequency. To illustrate, I'm 00.
Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Testing.
And I'm on lower sideband right now. And I'm using a little sideband rig into a dummy load here. And if I go to upper sideband and select the same frequency and key up.
Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4.
You'll see that I'm still able to copy, and I didn't even touch the radio. So the radio can sit dead center on frequency, and you can switch between upper and lower sideband, and you're going to copy just fine. That's if you're in the center of the bandpass. And the audio response is very good. It's wide enough. Now, I suppose if you were to play with the selectivity, you might be able to narrow things up a little bit, and you might be able to tune out one sideband. But if you got to do that kind of thing, you probably want an HQ170 or 180. This one's good enough to copy sideband very, very nicely. And I've got it aligned and calibrated by adjusting the oscillator coil right here so that maximum carrier or center carrier on the meter is also deadbeat center frequency on the BFO, beat frequency oscillator. And so we should be able to copy upper and lower sideband just peachy keen, no problem. Okay, I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time doing the alignment on this radio because it's so friggin' simple. You'll notice that there's like three IF transformers, T5, T6, T7. Well, anyway, no biggie. You can go right to the grid of the mixer with a 455 signal, capacitively inject it, and then just peak for maximum on T5, T6, and T7. This is one of these radios that, you know, you can drive a truck through, so you don't need to sweep align it or anything like that. And once you've aligned for the 455, then you can inject a signal into the antenna. And in this case right here, we're going to peak for maximum signal on the S meter for T3, and then you can come over here and peak the bottom slug on what would be considered L1. They don't mark it in the book, they don't mark it on the radio, but basically the bottom slug, and you can peak for maximum signal strength, and the book will tell you at which end of the band to do that. So I've always liked to peak it right at the ham radio frequencies. So to each your own. And then each band correspondingly has got its own coil, T1 to be the broadcast band, and so forth. So you can peak each one of the signals with a signal generator. I'm using a really old ancient SG85 here, and it's actually, I've checked it against the Motorola service monitor, and after half a century it's still pretty accurate. Anyway, what I wanted to show you is I just peaked the 75 meter band, and you'll hear a tone in there. And if you look up here, you'll notice that we're on the 0.1 scale and we're on 5. So 0.1 times 5, we're looking at a half a microvolt signal. And just to show you, it's coming out of the signal generator. So despite this not being a high-end receiver, it is pretty sensitive. I'm going to do the same exercise with all the other bands and throw it back in the case. We look like we're getting really close. Now we're starting to do our alignment at the very low end of the band, and you might keep in mind that there is no real coil or alignments for the very bottom of the broadcast band. They tell you that right in the book. Well, we'll just go through each one of the procedures just so I can say I did. I'm injecting a 455 kilohertz signal with a little 5-puff probe on the first mixer, rid of the first mixer, and this is really complicated. We could use a voltmeter as they indicate in the instructions, but in this kind of a receiver, S meter looks great. So watch the S meter. I'm going to hit the first IF. Second IF. Third IF. That's it. told you it was simple. Okay, so 455 is aligned, and I'm using a Motorola service monitor set up on 455 kilohertz. And this is a single conversion radio, so be aware that when you're aligning it that you're going to run into images, and the images will be higher in frequency in this receiver than the main signal. So don't align peak and tweak on an image frequency. You'll be disappointed. We'll start at the very bottom band and go through and set the frequency and peak the antenna, and then we'll move up to the next band. All right, we're on the very bottom band, 0.54 to 1.6, and we're looking at the S meter as well as T1. Book says to peak T1, and we like to do that with the antenna adjustment roughly in the middle. And I'm actually on 1 megahertz, so just to give you for reference. And there's our peak right there on the meter. And we can verify that and double check it with the antenna adjustment. That's it. There is no adjustment for the play to the RF amp, not on the bottom band. So we'll move up to the next band and do the same thing. Oh, one thing I should mention is that we've got the band spread at 100. It's at the top of the range. And we're going to do that for all of the adjustments. Okay, we've moved up to the next band, 1.6 to 4.0, and we're injecting a signal at 4 megs. One of the reasons I'm doing this is because I want the amateur band to be hot if I can, because that's what I'm going to use it for. T2, go over to the meter. There's our peak. And then we'll go over here to the bottom slug. Bottom slug of L1. They don't mark it that way, but that's the case. And there's our peak. And that's done. You'll notice that the 4 meg signal is resting on 4 megahertz. Now I'm going to show you pretty quickly how we can refine that, but there is the second band up. Okay, I've got the receiver set at the upper part of the band on the third band, 9 megahertz, and I'm going to touch things up with T3. There's our peak there, and then I'm going to come over and touch things up on L2. This is one of the coils that was all taken apart. And there we go. It seems to peak very nicely. And there's our antenna peaking. Comes in just fine. Okay, let's move up to the top band. See what we get. Okay, we're tuned at 26 megahertz on the main dial. Now we're going to go over to T4 and peak for that. That looks pretty good. Kind of back the signal down a little bit. And then we're going to go over to, again, that coil that was all taken apart here. And we're supposed to peak the top. And that's about it right there. Go back and do T4 again. Try this again, I got a better tuning tool. There's a nice peak right there. Okay, now let's see what kind of sensitivity we're getting at 26. Well, it's not wonderful. It's half a microvolt there, you can just barely hear it. Let's go up to a full microvolt. Okay. Alright, so that's 1 microvolt right there. That's okay, but not wunderbar. But anyway, that's the top band. And antenna peaks just fine. Now we'll go back and touch up the frequencies. We're going to set the local oscillator so that it agrees with the dial, and this will be the second band. First band was dead on. And we're going to tune for 3.8. And there you go. Now, there's two coils or two adjustments here, two here, and each one of those can adjust the same thing. But what you're adjusting is the width between the graticules on the dial. So depending upon where you have this little fine capacitor adjusted and where you have the coil adjusted, that's going to depend upon how well this thing tracks. I've done a preliminary check and decided not to muck with the coil adjustment because it's really close. Okay, we're going to go back and look at the lowest coil. Decided that we're just a little bit of a smidge off here, and I'm going to adjust for one mag. Okay, one mag it is. Okay, we're going to do the last band. And boy, touchy, huh? Last coil right here. I think that's as close as we're going to get it. Okay, 26 megahertz. Not too shabby. And we've got one more band here, and then I think we're there. All the noises about the fluorescent lights are just horrid. Just realized I could just turn it off and make things a lot quieter. Okay, what we're listening to here is a pretty weak signal, actually. Yeah. 0.1 times 5 with modulation, and that's on the broadcast band, and that's a 1 megahertz. Peaks real good, very nice, and all the other bands basically the same, with the exception of the top band, and yeah, it takes about 2 microvolts or so to get a decent signal on 26 megahertz. So this isn't what I call a real performer on the top bands. I've got one more thing I want to do to this thing, and then I'm going to put it back in the case. But I want you to look that it's got a jack back here that needs to go, and I'm going to put in a SO239. Or maybe even a BNC female jack, so that it'll mate with the rest of the equipment that I got. So that's got to go. Okay, well, I think that's pretty much it. And there's the BNC fitting, which should make connecting communications gear up a little bit easier. And I'm going to plug her in one more time and try it out. Okay, there we go. Putting in 1 megahertz, and half a microvolt. It looks very good. Back in the case she goes. The truth is at hand. We have the HQ200 set up, perched atop my Hammarlund 170 Alpha. I can't compare anything but the ham bands, but I just thought you might find it interesting to listen to what general coverage receiving sounds like now with the unit tuned up. It's actually pretty good. So let's kind of go up here to the main dial, and I'll turn up the volume, and you'll hear a little bit of electric fence in there, but...
Hey Giants fans, don't miss your last regular season.
Prices are ordered.
I can scream the lack of it.
Who's out there?
Captain Ed.
Captain Ed.
Captain Ed.
Captain Ed. Talk to any player, talk to any coach. It's all about the football. And that's the only reason that defense is out.
Okay, there you go. That'll give you an idea. And it's receiving the broadcast band really, really well. Interestingly enough, though, this unit, if you go up to the next band, continues the broadcast band. And we can kind of zip down here to the other end of the dial, and it picks back up where the other band left off. So there's still a few more stations to be at. That's it. So there's the broadcast band. Let's kind of take a peek at the amateur radio bands and do a A-B comparison. Both radios are sharing the same antenna to an AM station on the 75 meter band, right around 3880, 85 And we'll compare. This is a very red hot 170 alpha. Okay, and this is the 200. Well, I actually can't tell any difference. Same signal strength, and the 200 might have a little bit better fidelity. But that's kind of where the edge ends. Sideband-wise, the 170 alpha is a lot better. But let's try sideband on the 200 just for giggles here and see what it sounds like. Okay, here we go.
73 for now, and thanks for letting me know what's going on here. OCS, somewhere south of Portland, W17, QE, Grand 73, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Have a good time and enjoy.
Yeah.
Life is too short not to. Thank you very much for your consideration.
Okay, well, as you can see, both units receive sideband pretty well. And you'll also notice the product detector in the HQ200 works pretty well. I had the sensitivity turned up pretty high, and yet we were still able to copy a single sideband signal. So, looking pretty good. Let's zip up to 40 meters and check that band. Well, there we go. There's some 40 meters.
Encourages you to write to your favorite programs and let them know they are.
Soft drinks are. Something to God.
A lot of religious broadcasts above the 40 meter band. And lots of Oriental broadcasts. Pretty strong, too. Well, let's go on up to 20 meters and see if there's anything up there. I think we kind of run out of luck. I got all upset because I couldn't hear anything on 20 meters when I went up there, but come down here and start tuning around, there's nothing. The band's dead. So I have to wait for another day to demonstrate 20 meters. But that's it, folks. Hammarlund HQ 200 done. Ready to be put back into action and take its rightful place amongst the other boat anchors. I sure appreciate all your interest, and thanks for following me along. I wish this had been a little bit more technical, but I keep forgetting that what might be obvious and simple to me might not be to other folks if they haven't actually worked on them, as some of the new solid-state theories and so forth are a little bewildering to me. So please forgive me for not being too thorough, but I hope you enjoyed the video and keep your eyes open for more to come, because we've got lots and lots in the offing waiting to be repaired. 73's Pete, K7PP.